Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for coming. My name is Clay Gillette. I'm a professor here at NYU. The term crisis gets thrown around a great deal these days, perhaps too much, but I don't think it's anywhere close to too strong of a term to describe the current state of state and municipal fiscal affairs. Just some quick examples. The gap between public pension and health obligations incurred by states and municipalities and the funds that have been set aside to pay those obligations is reported to exceed $1.25 trillion right now. Some states are thought to be at risk of default on their general obligation bonds. The capital of Pennsylvania, as well as several smaller municipalities, have filed for bankruptcy under Chapter 9 of the Bankruptcy Code, either to avoid bad investments or to attempt to reject collective bargaining agreements that they deem to be onerous. Four municipalities in Michigan have had their elected leaders replaced by state-appointed emergency financial managers, and Detroit is thought to be on the verge of going into the same situation. Reduced housing prices threaten to reduce collections of property taxes on which municipalities are financially dependent. And some states have sought to reduce the collective bargaining rights of public sector unions in an effort to balance budgets. How did we get here? How do we get out? Those are the key questions that we're going to be discussing for the next hour and a quarter. And we're privileged to have with us to further this discussion a remarkably distinguished panel to address these issues, Jonathan Ballan, Richard Ravitch, and Lillian Roberts. Mr. Ballan is a member of the firm of Mintz, Levin, Cohn, Ferris, Glovsky, and Popeo, and is one of the nation's leading bond lawyers. He has served as bond counsel or underwriter's counsel in some of the most significant recent public financings in the New York area, including the new Yankee Stadium, financings for the New York Liberty Development Corporation, which was established to rebuild the area near the World Trade Center, the New Jersey Nets arena at Atlantic Yards. Somehow that geography works for some people, and the Metropolitan Transit Authority. He has been active in public service as special counsel to the Empire State Development Corporation and as a member of the board of the MTA, but perhaps most significantly as the last chairman of the Municipal Assistance Corporation of the City of New York, the agency established to assist New York City out of the fiscal crisis of the 1970s. Mr. Ravitch, to my immediate left, has had lifelong involvement with public affairs at just about every level of government imaginable, with special roles in government entities facing fiscal crisis, getting them out of it, not getting them into it. He has served as an attorney for the House Government Operations Committee in Washington, chairman of the New York State Urban Development Corporation. He played a major role in the New York City fiscal crisis in the 1970s, chaired the Metropolitan Transportation Authority, and was president of the Players Relations Committee of Major League Baseball. He was appointed co-chair of the Millennial Housing Commission created by Congress in 2000 to consider ways of increasing the availability of affordable housing. In 2009, Governor Patterson appointed Mr. Ravitch to serve as Lieutenant Governor of the state. At the end of all that service, one might have thought that Mr. Ravitch had done enough, but instead he has formed, along with Paul Volcker, former Fed chairman, a task force on state fiscal crises. I will here put in a plug. Some of our students are doing some research for that task force. If any of you are interested in joining this effort, I'd be most interested in having you talk to me either after the forum today or at some soon point. We're having a lot of fun getting some research done. Ms. Roberts is serving her fourth term as Executive Director of District Council 37 of the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, New York's largest public employee union. She is also a Vice President of the New York State AFL-CIO, a Vice President of the New York City Central Labor Council, Co-Chair of the Municipal Labor Committee, and International Vice President of the American Federation, of AFSCME. Prior to her election as Executive Director of DC 37, Ms. Roberts served as New York State's Commissioner of Labor. Her rise to the head of DC 37 began with her service as a shop steward and officer of District Council 34 in Chicago. She subsequently moved to New York, organized city hospital workers, and served as associate director of AFSCME, or of District 37, under Victor Gottbaum. Under her leadership, District 37 currently represents 125,000 public workers in New York City and state, 50,000 retirees, 1,000 job titles, and 55 locals. So it's an extraordinarily distinguished panel that I think will enlighten us today. I've asked each of our panelists to make some very brief initial remarks. I'll then ask a couple of questions to see if we can get at some of the issues that involve us right now, and then I'll open this up for additional conversation from the audience. So let me begin with John Ballan. John?
Thank you, Clay. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to serve on this panel with such distinguished co-panelists and such an impressive forum. I don't know, really, I didn't know and don't know what year people are. I assume it's mostly students. And I just remember he said the name of my law firm. He did it very well. I remember when I was going to interview with them as I was coming laterally on the plane up from New York, where our main office is in Boston, I realized that I better learn the name of the firm. And so I spent about 15 minutes trying to get the different names straight because, of course, like most of these law firms, the people are long deceased who the firm's named after, and it makes no sense to a newcomer. So anyway, I am a partner, we call a member, at Mintz, Levin, Cohn, Ferris, Glovsky, and Popeo PC. So if you're interviewing at our firm, try and learn the name. That'll be very impressive. So just to reiterate, I'm a bond attorney and head of the New York Public Finance Group at Mintz Levin, which is the way to say it. I'm not a bankruptcy attorney or even a bond workout specialist, although we have some good ones at my firm. I basically strive to close deals for clients and hope that we never discuss the transactions post-closing except to visit completed facilities, which I like to do as much as I can when it's something like Yankee Stadium and not necessarily when it's a sewage treatment plant, or to discuss additional bonds needed to complete construction or refunding bonds as interest rate environment improves and that type of thing. Anything I say here today are my own remarks, not those of my law firm, and especially not those of the MTA on which I serve on the board, as I believe Clay just mentioned. I'll speak just for 3 or 4 minutes about fiscally troubled local governments from my perspective as a bond attorney who has some public sector board experiences at MAC, Health and Hospitals Corporation, the Public Asset Fund, a few other entities, and now MTA. But it's mostly my private sector experience that structures my thoughts and thinking, as well as my, political beliefs and philosophy. Clearly, the fiscal condition of numerous state and local governments remains perilous today, particularly at the local level, where the tax base is narrow and state mandates are burdensome. But there's less chatter of possible massive new muni bond defaults this January, as governments have retaken control over their financial situation over the past year compared to the previous year, when things looked dire. Some states' revenues have increased in 2011 over 2010, primarily due to tax hikes, but the recession continues in most areas of the country, and the future budgetary balance of local governments is shaky unless the economic activity escalates and improves. Fortunately, and as I predicted in another panel that I was on under Clay's leadership last year, the over-the-top rhetoric of some that there would be billions of dollars of muni defaults in 2011 did not come true. But the risk of fiscal turmoil will continue until government officials figure out how to balance required services with desired tax structures. Although the past year's legislative session has widely been considered a success in Albany, New York State for years has been accused of having a dysfunctional legislature. Without getting into the details of that argument, and the accusation, in fact, may be true, but one area where the state has been reasonably responsible has been with respect to fiscal bailouts of local governments in need. New York does not have a formal program of oversight protection, but the state legislature creates oversight boards on a case-by-case basis, and the ability to file Chapter 9 under the bankruptcy code exists in New York. The most famous example of an oversight board for a fiscally troubled local government, of course, was New York City, where the Municipal Assistance Corporation for the City of New York was created in response to the fiscal crisis in 1975, and MAC had oversight responsibilities. Lieutenant Governor Ravitch was a key person with key experience on MAC, and I had the privilege of serving as the final chairman from 2001 until its controversial sunset about 8 years later. I must have done such a good job because the dysfunctional legislature got together at 4 a.m. one night, passed a special law doing away with MAC and my chairmanship, and also refunding some MAC bonds in a very controversial and expensive way. And just to complete the picture, MAC split the oversight role with the State Financial Control Board, which was created a little after MAC, but they worked together and should be viewed together with respect to oversight protections. MAC enabled the city to enter the capital markets when the city couldn't, and it forced the city to undertake budgetary, accounting, and financial reforms. The Financial Control Board actually had great broad powers to monitor and approve city budgets and contracts. And the FCB, as it's known, continued in existence, although with reduced powers. And this made bondholders very comfortable because they knew that if there was some type of problem, the Financial Control Board would come in and set things straight. So the mere existence of the continuation of the FCB has been very helpful also for political leaders who could always blame a possible FCB takeover to encourage reluctant negotiating parties to the table. Other localities in New York have had oversight boards recently, including Buffalo, Nassau, and Erie County, and Yonkers used to have one, but it was disbanded, although they have special laws that help provide comfort for their bondholders. So the creation of various oversight boards allows troubled municipalities to avoid filing for bankruptcy protection under Chapter 9. If there's one piece of advice that I've spoken to a number of muni bankruptcy lawyers and experts, if there's one thing that they all agree upon, it's that Chapter 9 filing should only be undertaken as a last resort. It cuts off the access to capital markets. They're expensive and demoralizing to a community, and they contain great risk and uncertainty because there's so little case law under Chapter 9, which might be good if you're studying it as a law student, but it makes it very difficult to predict what's going to happen as a government official. But Chapter 9 filings allow for restructuring of costs, and they do have some potential benefits. But they're not used in New York widespread. In fact, the only one I know of is when OTB tried it and it didn't work out for them and they had a dissolving controversy. The control boards provide new credits for raising capital and leadership to make necessary but perhaps unpopular decisions. And they can address the root causes of crises. But they do take away local autonomy. But there are control boards are more transparent than bankruptcy courts. But the solution to the fiscal problems facing state and local governments rests with the elected officials. Will the economic downturn reverse and relieve pressure on fiscal pressure on governments? Will state and local governments maintain control of their budgets as the stimulus money dries up? Can the workforce expenses be controlled? We'll see. But we know that infrastructure needs are widespread and the capital to finance the needs must be met. So the potential exists for tensions between bondholders, and that's how the governments raise the capital by issuing bonds, and the service providers. It will be a very interesting period as we move forward. Thank you.
Will, can I ask you to make some remarks?
Well, I was going to talk a bit about contracting out insourcing. It was mentioned by the president. And our experience is that the bulk of it doesn't work. And it has cost workers jobs. The last group that was laid off were workers making approximately $19,000 a year. And because they laid them off because the mayor said he did not have money, and it's costing the citizens of New York $90,000 a year as a safety net for them. And at the same time, he contracted out, he took the money that was there and contracted it out. And these contracts have been found to be fraudulent. And I'm now going to be demanding their job back and somebody be arrested for the over $1 billion of money that has been involved in fraud with three contracts, just three. And we still have seven more to go. And what I think is important, we had a congressional briefing because I feel that the money comes in and is specified for certain reasons and a certain use, it should be used for that purpose. And if it's contracted out of the state, out of the country, we all suffer. And therefore, this has to come to light. And I'm very happy that the president wants to pay for insourcing, because that's why many of the individuals who go to school don't have jobs, because they don't even consider them. And so my feeling is that that is the source. Mismanagement is the start of trying to correct a crisis situation that shouldn't even exist.
Thank you.
Not sure quite where to begin. Yeah. Let me say, with all respect to distinguished counsel on the right, I profoundly disagree with the assertion that the legislature is dysfunctional. And no more dysfunctional than any other part of government, and it works better than the Congress of the United States works. what's really happened, to put this in some perspective for you, is that we, as a society, decided over the last 75 years that we wanted to use our resources to produce a more fair and just society and to create benefits, whether it be paying for health care for the elderly, paying for health care for the poor, Social Security, assuming a variety of obligations to make this society better. And we lived until fairly recently with a rate of growth in our economy that supported this marvelous impulse in the social policies that through our governments we as a society adopted. I believe that in the most recent years, and I'm sad to say for this foreseeable future, the rate of growth of our economy and therefore of our revenues at current taxing levels are not sufficient to pay for the benefits that we have promised the public at large. and therefore, though it plays out very differently from one jurisdiction to another, some places are in much worse shape than others. We now have, in most jurisdictions in this country, the following. The federal government is cutting back. The president said last night he's going to cut another $2 trillion out of the budget. It is indisputable that most people on both sides of the political aisle in Washington think that a significant part of those cuts are going to come out of the $560 billion that is in the federal budget that represents pass-throughs to state and local governments. And states are dealing with enormous budget stringencies by cutting local aid. And most of what states spends are directly or indirectly local aid. Whether in the form of aid to education, social services, welfare, Medicaid, whatever the case may be. So close to 70% of New York State's budget is, in effect, pass-throughs to local, county, and municipal governments in New York, all of which are terribly, terribly pressed. New York City's budget forecasts, which are mandated by the law that we created in 1975, show that for the first year of the next mayoral election, the city will have a deficit of over $5 billion, and that doesn't even take into account the risk of any further federal cuts or further of further state cuts. And it doesn't take into account that the rate of earnings subsumed for pension calculation purposes is going to change. And I think all of those are unrealistic assumptions. In upstate cities, though the state passed a property tax cap in the spring, most upstate communities are finding it difficult, if not impossible, to live within the revenue revenues that they're currently getting. A number of them have, as the state law permitted, have reversed by votes, three-quarter votes in their legislative bodies, to eliminate the property tax cap so they had enough money to do street repairs, maintain police and fire, public safety, and meet their obligations to the pension system, although most of them are borrowing from the state pension fund to make the payments that they're statutorily obligated to make. New York State, every state is unique because of its constitutional framework, because of its statutory framework. Let me just spend a couple of minutes on New York, which obviously I know best. And that is that New York has, for over 25 years, balanced its budget by using what are known as one-shots. They use the proceeds of asset sales, they use the proceeds of borrowing to balance their budget. Now, most states, if not all states in the United States, have balanced budget requirements. But no state defines revenue in a way that the law that applies to the city of New York defines revenue. New York City, as a result of the fiscal crisis that Mr. Ballan correctly described, requires that the city's recurring revenues match its recurring expenditures in accordance with GAAP, generally accepted accounting principle. That was the most significant thing we did in 1975. And because that represented a very fundamental departure from the way the city had managed its fiscal affairs prior to that, we gave the city 4 years, I say we, the legislature and the governor, gave the city 4 years to achieve real, honest budget balance. And the city accomplished that goal. When the state began to run into a great deal of pressure on the difference between their expenditures and their revenues, they responded by selling assets. I'll give you an illustration. The first one is they sold Attica Prison to a public benefit corporation, took the proceeds of sale of $250 million, treated that as a revenue for budget balancing purposes, leased it back, of course, because the state operates the prison, and the public benefit corporation sold $250 million of bonds backed by a lease from the state, the rent payments of which are subject to annual appropriation by the legislature. So that no bondholder, if this legislature didn't appropriate the rent, no bondholder would have an enforceable claim against the state for the debt service on those bonds. And which, by the way, is indistinguishable from the moral obligation bonds that Nelson Rockefeller sold, that everybody swore they would never do again. And we have, since that date, we've borrowed money, we've issued debt that is not secured by revenue, is secured only by, and I'm not suggesting it isn't money good, but backed only by an expectation that the legislature would honor a contractual obligation, which, as I say, they have to date. And if you look at the numbers and the growth of healthcare costs, and therefore the growth of Medicaid, New York State spends $53 billion a year in Medicaid. That's over a third of their budget. You look at the enormous pressure, political pressure, to reduce taxes. and that has, unfortunately, a lot of political traction. You look at the rectitude that people express about public employees when they suggest that the way to deal with the fiscal problem is to cut back on pensions for public employees and cut back on their health care. And as if they're the ones who are responsible for the enormous disparity that exists. So we're entering into a fascinating period created for the benefit of law students, because there are so many interesting legal questions about priorities, obligations, and so much of the law with regard to these issues of pension, the sanctity of pension obligations, the classification of the different kinds of public debt. Those kinds of issues are, most of which are being litigated through state courts and federal courts at the moment, and there's no clear solution, but it's a fascinating field. I'm sorry, Clay, for talking too long. Really.
No, not at all. In fact, it's a wonderful segue into what I want to ask as the first series of questions. So one of the themes that runs through all these initial remarks is not simply the existence of a crisis, but of competing stories about about the source of the crisis. So one might suggest, looking at the inability of upstate cities in New York and elsewhere, because I don't want to confine our discussion to New York, one might suggest that the crisis is truly a fiscal crisis, that is, municipalities in an era in which the federal government is cutting back, in an era in which manufacturing bases are leaving cities, simply do not have the capacity to generate funds sufficient to pay their obligations. One might suggest, however, consistent with some of the things Ms. Roberts is concerned about with respect to privatization or outsourcing, or with respect to tax structures, as Lieutenant Governor was suggesting, that the true crisis is simply one of politics, of political will. Mm-hmm. There's some theory out there, and I want to ask our panelists about what they think of the theory, that when it comes to the contentious issue of pensions, there is a strong likelihood that elected officials will grant large pensions to public employees, public sector unions, in return for political support, and that they will grant large pensions in lieu of large salary increases, because large salary increases hit the budget on their watch, on that mayor's watch. Pensions hit on some future mayor's watch. And that might be a trade-off that helps explain why we have this pension gap. So I guess I want to ask our panelists, do we have a true fiscal crisis with respect to state municipal budgets, or do we have a political crisis, if I can draw that potentially false dichotomy? Any thoughts? Any thoughts you're willing to express in public?
I'll express anything. You know, so.
Go ahead, John.
I think it's both, but I do want to support one thing you said and make three quick points. I do note, to support what you said, that there are debt limits when you issue bonds, particularly general obligation bonds. I promise you could have two seminars on this topic, probably, and you can't get to it all today, and I definitely don't mean to be pedantic. But there are different types of bonds with different types of structures, with different ramifications upon default and different remedies. So if you have general obligation bonds versus revenue bonds versus special dedicated tax bonds versus project bonds, you have a whole series of different outcomes upon fiscal difficulties. So to draw one conclusion is literally impossible. But the point I'll try and make is that there are debt limits. You can only limit debt under certain circumstances, certain amounts, sometimes a vote, sometimes not a vote. But there are no, that's in the Constitution, but there are no constitutional limits on pension increases. In fact, there's the opposite. It's argued that the Constitution guarantees the pensions can't be cut. So it has an opposite effect. So you can't issue debt because the theory was that that would be under someone else's watch and it's not appropriate to take all the credit for something and have a future administrations have the challenge of paying for it, but the same thing's accomplished by these unlimited pension increases. The couple of quick points, and if that was too long, just cut me off, Clay.
I will.
The system tends to react only to, well, not only, but to crisis situations, and until there's a major crisis, there's delay. That's the nature of the system. I'm not commenting on whether it's good or bad. But I hope that this current fiscal crisis, and there's clearly a fiscal crisis, it's probably a political crisis, it's a whole bunch of crises in one, doesn't pass without reforms being taken to solve the political side of things. And what I especially mean by that is, as revenues, if you read the literature, if you look at any of this, the data, revenues at the state level are, for the most part, this is factual, you can go state by state, and this is published by various entities, governmental entities. Revenues are not what they were pre-fiscal crisis, the onset of which was in 08, but they're definitely better than they were 2 years ago and last year. So this, it seems to be finding an equilibrium, and I hope that this fiscal side doesn't pass without certain reforms being taken. And the last point is, one of the problems that the lieutenant governor was mentioning, and I want to support, is the local mandates on, especially if you look at what a county, again, is another topic, but what a county government does. I mean, what county governments have the benefit of doing is basically implementing policies and programs mandated upon them by the state legislature and governor. But the state legislature and governor, who then take credit for solving the problem, then say, oh, by the way, you have to pay for it, so go hike the county taxes to pay for it. Most of county government, I'm not talking about New York City now, most of county government in New York State is through mandates, which is interesting and not what a lot of people know. And then the last quick point was a lack of jobs and the decreasing population is a very significant aspect to why the tax revenues are down and the service needs are up upstate. And just to correct, if I may, one last point, the distinguished lieutenant governor, I didn't say that the legislature was dysfunctional. I said, and I quote, it's been accused of having a dysfunctional legislature,
The accuser, I might add, the accusers include the Brennan Center of New York University School of, well, forget that. Fiscal, political, sorry. Both?
Yeah. I think it's both, because I certainly don't think we have a fat pension. At 19, the average pension for the people we represent is $19,000 a year. And most of them have to work to the age of 62 to get that. That's not a fact. There's five different pension plans, by the way. And if you want to make any change, you talk to the individuals who will help you make that change. You don't come out with the press unless you got other agendas and nobody knows what you're talking about and keep talking about it, trying to educate the press that the pensions are so big. And at the same time, when one retire, the same mayor brings them back and let them work and get their pension. I don't understand that. And so, but the people we represent certainly don't have that. We have a cap on overtime. And you have overtime and big pensions because you don't have enough personnel. And so they play a very important part of that. And I really don't know how you work 6-7 years and go away and get a pension. Chancellor Klein's got some kind of pension. So these are the kind of things, is who you're talking to and what you want to accomplish. So it's both leadership and I think it's just a subject matter in order to do other things, to be very honest with you. We'll talk about those as we go along.
Your Honor, you want in on this or should I move on?
I could simply say that for the purpose of clarification, not to disagree, there is no dollar limit on the amount of full faith and credit debt the state can issue. It's subject to approval by the voters, and the voters have not approved a full faith and credit bond issue since 2005. They've approved very few, which is what forced the political system to devise other methods of borrowing money and going back many, many, many years. Do you disagree?
Yeah, no, I agree with you, but there's so many topics here. Cities and counties have debt limits, clearly, statutorily, constitutionally.
Well,
the state does not.
Yes, but they're related. It's important to understand. They also have thousands of ways of avoiding those debt limits by issuing debt from other entities other than the government.
Oh, yeah,
itself.
I work on as many of those as I can.
That's right. So I have strategically
seated myself between these two wonderful gentlemen. But I must say, since it's one of my, it's so close to my heart, that debt limitations get, I believe, Mr. Ballan, get honored in the breach these days. And the bond issues that Mr. Ravitch was talking about, that is the subject to appropriation bonds, which are a follow-on of the moral obligation bonds devised by
John
you're
Mitchell.
All too young out there to know the name, John Mitchell, the Richard Nixon's attorney general, subsequently imprisoned. The moral obligation, these were bonds that were devised as a subject to appropriation for the very purpose of they can circumvent debt limitations. So if you look in New York State or virtually any state at the amount of debt out there that satisfies the general obligation requirement and the amount of debt that is out there that has a claim on the same revenues as the general obligation bond, but it does not count for legal purposes under judicial opinions as debt for the constitutional debt limitation, that second group often exceeds the first. That arguably leads to part of the fiscal crisis that we are facing, although primarily our fiscal crisis now is not a debt crisis. Certainly the New York City fiscal crisis in the 1970s was a debt crisis. And it is plausible that as we move on, the combination of pensions and debt, I think, could be more problematic for the state than we currently realize. Is that something you would disagree with?
Each level of government has different laws and rules,
no doubt, that's
regulating the issuance of debt. I think you're correct if you look at the state and the city, New York City, but I don't think that you are correct if you look at the counties and the smaller localities. The localities, and if you look at the ratings reports for each of them, you'll see what I mean. But the localities have strict debt limits. Now, there are ways I spend a large part of my day, week, and year trying to devise ways around existing statutory, constitutional, and regulatory rules. That's, what clients pay me for. Yes. But we're not reckless, and we disclose all of it. But to a certain extent, some of them are legitimate and appropriate. And sometimes, I turn down transactions and things, bad ideas all the time. They should not be undertaken. They should not be undertaken because they're inappropriate, because the statutes are being interpreted wrong, incorrectly, the disclosure's improper, or a whole bunch of other reasons. But you're correct. But if you're extending that comment to the smaller divisions of government, I don't think you are correct.
All right. So full disclosure.
I have to say it's even more complicated than John says, because, for example, John, where's the Hudson Yard Infrastructure Corporation and $3 billion of debt? What category will you put that in?
That's a TIF. So that I would say that you're using
it's a TIF, hell will freeze over before the city gets enough revenue from that part of the city to pay the debt service on those bonds. It's being paid for out of the city.
I think your point is correct. I think it'll be sooner than hell freezing over, because development in the far west side will occur
hopefully rapidly,
particularly with the MTA finishing the extension of the 7 line. But your point on that is well taken.
Right.
That's taking property tax.
And how about the Yankee Stadium parking garage?
TIFs mean simply... TIFs mean simply that taxes that would otherwise, a select set of taxes that presumably represent the increment in value between the undeveloped and the developed property, that otherwise would have gone into the city coffers to pay for Ms. Roberts's represented workers, are now used to pay bondholders who have a claim on those incremental revenues. And because they're only incremental revenues that presumably would not have existed but for the development, those bonds don't count towards the city or the state's debt limitation. Yeah. Now, full disclosure, I used to do this before I took my vow of poverty and went into teaching. And I always remember a great Oregon case in which the Oregon Supreme Court struck down one of these plans with the wonderful line, "This is a scheme that would fool only a lawyer." All right. So let me ask a more pointed question. All right, because that one wasn't pointed enough. Let us assume for the moment that we are a municipality, such as some municipalities in Rhode Island are facing right now, municipalities in Michigan, municipalities in California, that can pay either its bondholders, its general obligation bondholders, that is those bondholders who have received a pledge of the faith and credit of the city to pay bonds basically come hell or high water, or can pay its obligations to its workers, to its public sector employees, but does not have resources to do both. As a legal matter, who has a first claim on those revenues, I think is up in the air. There are wonderful Depression cases that say bondholders have to give way to the essential needs of the municipality. And Rhode Island recently passed a statute that purported to give bondholders a first lien on municipal revenues prior to any claim that could be made even by the employees of the municipality. So, either as a legal matter or as a policy matter, let me ask our distinguished panelists, in that push comes to shove situation, which we may see with increasing frequency, who gets the money first?
Well, it's much more complicated, with all respect, Clay, than
that's
that.
Okay.
Because number one, the statute in Rhode Island simply said that if a municipality goes into bankruptcy, that the bankruptcy petition has to make it clear that debt will get paid ahead of other obligations. And whereas it doesn't reflect my own choice of values, they faced the situation in which the banks and Wall Street made it clear they wouldn't extend credit to any city or to the state unless they created that preference in their bankruptcy authorizing statute. Second of all, we had the case in New York where, in an effort to maintain the stability of our government in 1975, we enacted a moratorium on the payment of interest on the outstanding debt of the city. And the highest court in the state of New York, in a Flushing Bank case, said that the state had to use its constitutional taxing power to meet its obligations. So that was an unequivocal statement that you cannot avoid obligations just because you decide as a political matter not to fund them. Now, as far as pension obligations are concerned, this varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. And the distinctions exist because in some states there's no requirement that a state make the payment to the pension funds that they're supposed to make. New Jersey and Illinois are classic examples of those. And those pension funds are so dramatically underfunded that there is no way that the even the younger people who work for those state governments or the municipal governments that are covered by it are going to get their pensions paid unless something else happens. In New York, we've adopted a practice which is, again, in my view, not in the interest, in the long-term interests of public employees. The pension fund, the state and cities are borrowing from the pension fund the money that they are obligated statutorily in New York to contribute annually to the pension fund. So that is ultimately a kind of self-defeating exercise and is the equivalent of saying you don't have to make the payment. New Jersey, they just don't make the payments. And that's been true of Democratic and Republican governors. So you have a very critical question out there about the sanctity of pension benefit promises. And that's that's subject to litigation and much more ultimately if we get there than it is to a question of political priorities, although there are some people, and I'll finish with this, throughout this country who are trying to negotiate modifications to pension benefit arrangements, statutorily or through collective bargaining, in order to avoid the kind of crisis that would end up playing Russian roulette with the court system.
Ms. Roberts, how do you think your membership would react to being told, well, you've got to give up your some of your pension contributions that are supposed to be made by the city or the state so the bondholders can be paid?
Well, we were sort of ahead of that. We had a form in order to look at revenue. And what we found is the city's not collecting the taxes they're supposed to collect. They're not collecting from garages. They're deciding arbitrarily who's tax exempt. And when you take a look at all of these things, and they admitted it, by the way, because we sat down with them, they're not collecting from the billboards, cell phone towers. They're not doing their job. And if they're not doing their job, of course they're not going to have the money. So we had this form and submitted this information to them. And as a result, we had one meeting with the Finance Committee, who does not have enough staff to do the kind of things that they should do. And they began to slowly increase the revenue. So I can't even talk about that. When they do their job, then we're willing to sit down and talk. But we're not going to have things on our back because they failed to do their job. And a lot of these taxes, they're not collecting the entertainment taxes. When we brought that to them, where the clubs, the entertainment clubs, are not paying tax, then they came out with they're going to have them to pay for lap dances. I mean, what kind of joke is this? So we did our homework. We submitted to them. And here we are. You know, it's politics as to who pays the tax. And then they want you to feel like, oh, it's a crisis. I got to get something from you. I mean, that's the way I view it.
One quick comment from Mr. Ballan.
I think that there are just two quick points I want to make. It's amazing, and I have no doubt but to believe it's true, that we would leave tax revenue uncollected, and it's very unfortunate. And clearly, that's the first thing we should do is enforce our laws. So it raises the question of why that's not happening, and perhaps is that function one that should have some private sector help in some format if the public sector doesn't seem to be doing its number one essential job of collecting tax revenue. The other point I want to make is, as you talk about pensions versus, it's a little bit of a straw man that you set up intentionally, I think, Professor, but pension payment versus debt payment, I think that you have to keep in mind just two things, that if you don't pay debt service on your bonds, you'll be cut off access to the capital markets. So that school improvement you need, you won't have an ability to pay for it. That sewer that doesn't work, you won't be able to repair. The jobs it creates, the economic improvement it creates, and the more tax revenue it ultimately leads to, all will not happen. And the last part of that equation is, who are the bondholders? The bondholders, to a large extent today, are either retirees who can't get back into the workforce and improve their own lot, or pension funds, which are largely basically for retirees, and other investors who are risking their capital where they could invest it elsewhere to try and help governments improve the lot of their citizens. So you have to remember those factors.
I've got a bunch more questions, but I want to open it up to the audience and see if there are questions out there before I continue to monopolize the conversation here. Yes, I think do we run microphones? Is that the drill?
I think you can hear me. You had stated earlier that this theory that representatives had given pension funds in a way to incur political benefit. Couldn't you say the same thing about issuing bonds over taxes?
I'd be glad to answer that. I don't think that's, with all respect, bonds are issued or should be issued for only two purposes by government. One is for capital purposes, to pay for a physical improvement, because it is unfair to say that though five generations may enjoy the benefit of a schoolhouse or a bridge, that it should be paid for by one generation. So you amortize it over the useful life. So it's long-term finance. Plus, in the United States, it's distinct from other countries around the world. We have the advantage of being able to issue tax-exempt debt, so the interest cost is less. The other reason governments borrow is intra-year borrowing. If you don't collect your taxes annually at the same rate that you spend money, so in order to bridge the difference between your dates of tax collection, you borrow short term for that purpose. One of the reasons, there were several, but one of the reasons the city got into trouble in 75 was that it used that right to borrow short term, and they abused it by borrowing a lot more than they had the capacity to pay back, and they knew it. But they nonetheless borrowed it because they could get good opinions, and they could get Wall Street was willing to underwrite it and buy it. Actually, the banks themselves had almost half of that paper in their own portfolio. So, but it's very different. And let me say that there's no question that unions have a lot of political clout, but so does the real estate world, and so do the banks. If I told you all the solutions that the banks and their lawyers came up with to solve a fundamental budget problem by suggesting additional borrowings or securitizing existing revenues, which all do nothing but kick the can forward, I have to say that, you know, we're a free country. Anybody can lobby for anything they want. That raises a question about the use of the significance of political money in elections. So I don't single out the unions at all for in this regard, and I don't think it's a moral question. It's endemic to our system that if you have access to the elected officials who make decisions, you try to persuade them to do what's in your best interest.
I do completely agree with Mr. Ravitch. The Jefferson County, Alabama, has just filed the largest Chapter 9, largest Chapter 9 filing in the history of the nation, driven largely by a series of deals for which some dealers have now been indicted. So there are politics involved in this. There is certainly a theory analogous to the one that I presented before, that elected officials and municipalities suffer from what I would call an edifice complex, that they like to build. They have to build, as Mr. Ravitch says, but they like to because it gives them something to put their name on with some longevity. Additional question. I'm sorry.
Each state has laws restricting the issuance of bonds, and the federal tax code restricts what can be done on a tax-exempt basis. Sure. So you're protected from what you suggested through the two mechanisms that the Lieutenant Governor accurately set forth, but in addition to that, the tax code would limit the amount of bonds that you can issue for either working capital or deficit purposes.
Gentlemen, over the
you know, I'd like to ask an interesting question. I was just thinking about it yesterday. How is the office buildings at the World Trade Center a tax-exempt purpose?
They had some really good bond lawyers on the World Trade Center. We just worked on the deal. The reason is...
Oh, good job. Sorry, I didn't...
No, it's a great question.
But
and the answer...
He was the Yankee Stadium guy.
But not the...
That was absolutely wonderful financing, too. Pilots are the same as taxes. Yeah. But for World Trade Center 1, in particular, Liberty Bonds, after the terrorist attacks in 2001, Congress passed a law giving us the ability here in New York to issue Liberty Bonds, which were bonds to redevelop New York City, the bonds which would be for broad purposes, including office buildings, which typically are not financed on a tax-exempt basis, but it would allow the rebuilding of the downtown area on a tax-exempt basis through Liberty Bonds. That's what's been done. And It's taken a long time to do it.
This gentleman has been waiting patiently to ask a question.
Testing. Good? Good now?
Since you mentioned pensions, question about pensions, obviously there's this question about or have we not been making the contributions the pensions won't be able to pay out in the future. And one question that arises also is if there is this shortfall and if pensions in New York State, like other institutional investors, lost as a result of, you know, the fraudulently issued CDOs and the synthetic mortgage-backed securities and so forth, what is it, what can we do? Is there, I know that there was some consideration of either a private right of action under the Martin Act or some other way that pensions can recover this money. And so the question is, of course, you know, there's the pension obligations themselves, but then there's also the question of where did that pension money go? And is pension money of the future, and when we say pension money of the future, future taxpayers and so forth, is that being financed by, or sorry, are we financing that in the future because we let them pay for the bonuses today? So in other words, are the bonuses of today being paid for by the taxpayers of the future by not allowing us to recover that money that was fraudulently obtained to begin with?
Thank you.
By way of the Martin Act or so forth, some other sort of fraud, private right of action.
So I'm sorry.
I didn't understand all of the facts.
So the question is, if either the Attorney General or some private actor, can they bring suit so that we don't pay for these pension obligations down the road that have already gone off to pay for, you know, the mortgage-backed securities and the securities?
You mean, I think the question you're asking is, if the trustees of a pension fund were to have invested the proceeds in a improperly underwritten security.
So I'm assuming that premise is true, not just hypothetically true, but that it is a fact.
Well, I mean, that's a matter of some contention, and it's currently being litigated. And it's the subject of very significant settlement talks with the financial institutions that underwrote a lot of that paper, and it's, but do I think that the government will reimburse a pension fund trustee if it turns out that they purchased a piece of paper that was fraudulently issued? I think the answer is unequivocally no. There's no reason in the world why they should. The trustees bought the paper because they were advised by their financial advisors and the rating agencies that it was good, sound paper. So they weren't, they have no claim against the government for reimbursement.
But since it's defined benefit, it's not about that particular loss, right? It's just about we'll have to pay that obligation.
Well, let me put it to you this way. There are estimates that range anywhere from $1.8 trillion to over $3 trillion of underfunding of state and local pension funds in the United States. And there were some people who think that if that continues, that the federal government will ultimately bail it out. And that is a political speculative judgment, and it all depends on how much money you think the United States government is going to be able to borrow over the next 10 years, and how willing is the political system going to be to tax, to generate more revenue and taxes. I mean, that's a pure political speculation, and it's a long-term one. It's not a legal question.
Anything on the side? Zach? Zach.
This is probably a question for Mr. Ravitch, but I'd be interested in what you all have to say as well. It seems like a broader policy question, right, is that state fiscal policy in general is sort of pro-cyclical, right? So when there's a depression, states cut back, that deepens the recession. I wonder if you guys think that an effective policy intervention would be to create a state-run bank for New York that would provide cheap credit to the state or cheap credit to New York businesses modeled on, say, the Bank of North Dakota. And I know SEIU had come up with a similar proposal for Oregon. So I wondered what you guys had to say about that.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. Three parts to the answer. Number one, you know, we have markets, and buying money is like buying anything else in the marketplace. So the fact that the state creates a bank, and the state can't put its full faith and credit behind the borrowing of that bank without going to the voters. So we want to assume that the voters approved the assumption by a state entity of trillions of dollars or billions of dollars, then they could presumably lend that money out at a lower margin over their course. But that's a big assumption, and that's not likely to happen. I don't know anything about the workings of the State Bank in North Dakota. But second of all, I disagree with, and this is a very important point, states have not, in my view, handle the cyclical nature of our economy wisely, because in good times, when there's been an incremental amount of revenue, they've spent it. And the few states that had rainy day funds have already used them up. And I give you an illustration. I mean, there were two instances, one in the 80s and one in the 1990s, when our economy was roaring in New York, and in both times, two separate governors moved to reduce taxes instead of keeping taxes high. When we privatized, when there was a settlement of the tobacco litigation, Wall Street securitized, they came to the governor and they said, we could get you a couple of billion dollars, securitize those revenues. They took the proceeds of the bond sale, used it to balance the budget that year, and in subsequent years there was no more revenues coming through. I could give you illustration after illustration, and that's part of the problem. And if you do not have a budget system that says recurring revenues have to match recurring expenditures, the nature of the political system is such that they will never make adequate provision for the bad years.
I wanted to follow up on this gentleman's question because he raised a point that I had neglected. And so let me ask Ms. Roberts this. Virtually the only pensioners who now have defined benefit plans, which assures you a certain amount out, as opposed to a defined contribution plan, which assures you a certain amount in, are public sector employees. And some people have suggested that one way, not necessarily out of the current pension crisis, because it's not clear as a legal matter whether you could do this for existing employees, but some people have suggested to avoid future problems and to minimize the future problem, perhaps public sector employees should also have defined contribution plans rather than defined benefit plans. I'm just wondering, Ms. Roberts, what you or your membership would think about that shift.
I don't think they would like that very much because, first of all, they don't make enough money. You know, if you, I have a 401k and it goes up and down, and they want something that's a little more stable than that, and I think it's to all of our benefit that they obtain that, because otherwise we will wind up paying for everything that they can't pay for. And there's still some city employees who only have the pension, do not have Social Security, because they felt they couldn't afford both. So for us, I don't think it would work.
Dan, did you have a question?
You were mentioning the moratorium in the 70s in New York and the Flushing case. And I had heard that the case was decided on state constitutional grounds and was more sort of a rejection in form but not substance, because they were given a few years then to get their house in order. And that if it had gone up to the Supreme Court, it it likely could have been decided on contract clause grounds. And I guess my question is, if a city today were facing the same dire circumstances as New York was in the 70s and was facing police shutdowns and fire station shutdowns and decided to reorganize, do you think there's the same climate today? And is that the kind of thing that would result in the Supreme Court striking that down under contract clause grounds?
Let me try to answer you as best I can. All these questions have so many facets to them, it's hard to answer them simply. Number one, I think you have to remember that when New York got in trouble in 1975, it didn't have a budget system or an accounting system that was comprehensible to anyone. And we really didn't know. We knew that the city was borrowing short term for reasons they shouldn't have been borrowing short term. We knew they were using part of their capital budget for operating purposes, and it would take a while to straighten it out. So you're right that the 3 years that we, or the 2 years that we didn't pay interest on the debt, it helped us get through that period. You also have to remember that when we created MAC, and I'm sure Mr. Ballan would agree with this, that all we did was we took the sales tax away from the city of New York and legislated to MAC. So all the banks in the beginning said, we're not buying that stuff because we underwrote all the old general obligation bonds of the city, and you're taking the revenues away from the general obligation bondholder and hypothecating them to a new set of holders. And if the city subsequently goes into bankruptcy, who do you think is going to get their hands on that money, the MAC bondholder or the old general obligation bondholder? Well, fortunately, the city never went bankrupt, and that issue had never been litigated. I tend to think, based on my knowledge, that the holder of the revenue bond is a higher claim than the holder of the general obligation bond. But that, again, is a fascinating question that could, unfortunately, arise at any point in time. The decisions about, I'm not sure closing firehouses has anything to do with it. That's a question of how the political system chooses to spend the money that you honestly think you have.
Mr. Ballan.
No, I agree. I just want to point out that particularly since that time, the investing community has gotten very comfortable with these types of MAC type of structures with the segregation of sales tax. In fact, that's how the bailouts work, both in Buffalo with what's called BFSA, in Nassau with NYFA. That's the way these bailouts work. Yonkers is a slightly different thing, and I'm working actually on one or two more now. But the rating agencies and the bond community feel comfortable that Lieutenant Governor's correct. These are more secure securities, and that's the way they trade, that's the way they sell, that's the way they're structured. But and you have living history here. I my knowledge is from the 70s is through books and through experience and maybe chairing MAC and asking. But the only point I would want to just go back three questions without going too far back in the discussion today is I'd just like to respectfully disagree. And I don't think the mistake was in reducing taxes back when we were having a flush years. I think the mistake, if there was a mistake, was in being trying to be Santa Claus and hand out all the goodies to everybody and every interest group and everyone who wanted them. And we should have controlled the spending. Because if you look at the tax revenues have soared. And if you are either homeowners or taxpayers or talk to your parents or whomever, you'll find out about what's happened to property taxes and other taxes in the state. So I would seriously argue that it's a spending problem, not a revenue problem. And that's not to just come down against the unions. I think the unionized workforce needs to be treated well and fairly. Let's just say we need to have discipline, and I don't think we've had that type of discipline.
Well, let me say this. That is, this is a very legitimate issue, and it's the issue that our politics is really all about. If you think about all the dialogue that's gone on in Washington, it's all about taxes versus reductions. My own view is that we're not going to get out of the mess we're in locally or nationally without both, because the numbers are that bad. But I want to say.
But the argument, but the problems are different at the state level and the national level. The state has to balance its budget constitutionally, and the federal government runs deficits since the Keynesian days.
As we said, they can balance their budget by borrowing money. They do it all the time. They borrowed tens of billions of dollars and used it for budget balancing purposes.
On a limited basis, that's correct.
Proceeds of, yeah, so it's not really that different in reality. If you really look at the kind of debt that they're issuing.
I think we have...
I just really... I think we've got to get back to basics. First of all, when one is elected, the first thing they do is start throwing the goodies over the fence for the next job if they get in a powerful position to do so. We need to have an oversight committee that takes a look at continuity and how one action impacts on another. We don't have that. It's piecemeal. You know, they'll smash the little guy and blame him. He has nothing to do with what's come down on his or her head. And so I think we need to have a committee of some kind that we all trust, the bankers, the politicians, the unions, and then we can talk about, and the things that we pointed out that's not collected. You take the politics out of the basics, and then we can talk. And then we can talk about what we need to do to be more responsible. But I can't talk when all the buddies of the guys that are being elected is getting all the goodies and they want to smash us. I can't talk about that. That's why you don't see me engaging, because it doesn't have to be that way.
I think we have time for one more quick question and one more quick series of responses.
Full disclosure, I'm actually a member of DC 37 and a reporter. I just want to remark on the public comment about the public policy debate that I think it's really rather disingenuous to suggest that the whole issue of revenue is a real problem, or excessive taxation. If you look at the data objectively, the Fiscal Policy Institute in Albany has a graph, or has suggested, that since Cuomo, if you take away all the tax breaks you have given the rich, and in general the tax breaks, there would be no deficit problem. Now, when Cuomo Two.
I have to ask you if there's a question because we only have 3 minutes left.
Okay, Cuomo II institutes the tax break, gets rid of on the millionaire tax. And if the millionaire tax were allowed to be extended, we would have $5 million in revenue this year instead of two.
So
the question is, I mean, to what degree is all of this a matter of political debate?
That's all it is.
I'm not sure anyone has a response.
Okay. No, I we don't have enough time to enter into that.
All right. So with that.
I don't agree with a lot of what was said, and there's just no point starting that discussion when we're ending.
So with that, I want to, first of all, thank the audience, but primarily to thank our panelists for what I think was a relatively lively discussion.
I got it. It was nice to see you.